You're listening to the audio production of Finding Joy in the Empty Nest, Discover Purpose and Passion in the Next Phase of Life, by Jim Burns, published by Zondervan and read by Wayne Campbell. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit harperchristianaudio.com. To Terry and Sharon Hartshorn, you have taught us so very much about living in the empty nest, with generosity, commitment, devotion to family, fun, and faith. Thank you. Introduction. Get ready for something new. On the drive home from dropping our youngest daughter off at college, my wife and I both went silent for about 2 hours. Periodically, I looked over at Kathy, and more than a few times, I watched a tear take a stroll down her cheek. If someone had been watching us, they would have thought that instead of experiencing a beautiful transitional moment in our family's life, we were mourning the death of a loved one. When we arrived home, the house that had been headquarters to constant action, no little amount of tension through the teen years, noise, movement, chaos, laughter, memories, traditions, and more noise, was tomb-like quiet. We had just entered the empty nest, and not only were we unprepared, but we had been so busy with life that we hadn't even seen it coming. The following night, I sat down to dinner. Kathy had prepared a massive amount of food. She said, "I guess I need to adjust my cooking portions." As I performed my nightly kitchen cleanup duty, I put more food back into the refrigerator than we had eaten. Yes, we were going to have to make some adjustments, and we later realized it wasn't just in meal planning, but in practically every aspect of our lives. After all, we had just devoted 23 years to the daily parenting of our children, who had now morphed into adults, sort of, and we were no longer needed on a day-to-day basis. In addition, we had buried a few of our marriage issues under the taking care of the kids mat, and we had some work to do. Just about the time we were getting used to the empty nest, our adult children started moving back home, and we had to learn how to do life with boomerang children. All three of our girls came back through our revolving door several times. Authorities tell us that the average age to begin empty nesting is 48.7 years. We think our last boomerang happened a few months ago, at age 67. But hey, isn't 60 the new 40? No doubt the transition to the empty nest was harder on Kathy. I had my work and was overly focused on it. Kathy was still working as a teacher, but in our home, she had been the sun and we were all her planets. She was a bit lost without her leadership role. I think she was depressed for a while, but a husband's diagnosis should sometimes go unmentioned. We later learned she was experiencing what is called the empty nest syndrome. As a bit of foreshadowing, I'll share an observation from Heidi, our youngest, when she was about 5 years old. Trying to figure out the pecking order of our family, she asked, "Dad, if Rebecca, middle child, bosses me and Christy, our oldest, is the boss of Rebecca and Mom is the boss of everybody, then are you the boss of anyone?" But Kathy wasn't the only one who discovered she needed to reinvent herself. I had some work to do in that department myself. For many people, the empty nest brings other issues to the forefront, such as being caught in the middle of caring for aging parents, caring for needy adult children, health issues, menopause, and changing roles in marriage. Sometimes in-law issues get complicated, as do the problems of finances and future retirement. The list can quickly become a long one. Our road undoubtedly will be full of twists and turns and some unexpected thorns, but even with all that life naturally throws at us, I'm convinced that if you take just a little time to prepare, the empty nest years can be your best years. Many individuals spend more time in the empty nest than with their children in the home. Whether you are single, married, or in a blended family, the empty nest brings both the joy of victory and the agony of some defeat. You make midlife course corrections. If you are married, you once again gaze into each other's eyes, as you did before you had kids, though those eyes may have more wrinkles and your faces may be fuller than they were 2 decades ago. Unless you did an amazing job preparing for the empty nest, and most of us didn't, you may be looking at a stranger who is going through their own identity crisis. I've spent my entire adult life researching, speaking on, and writing about the values of strong marriages, confident parents, and empowered kids. Yet the empty nest took me by surprise. It was much more difficult than I'd thought it would be. And if this makes any sense, much better, too. I've told friends that I wrote this book out of my need, desperation, to reinvent and recalibrate parts of my life, my marriage, and even my relationships with my adult children. Very quickly, the research for this book became personal because I found myself reading for my own benefit before I could write or speak one sentence to others. To be candid, some of the writing on this subject seemed a bit trite, even shallow. Plant a garden, join a bridge club, and volunteer at the hospital. These are great ideas, but as I listened to the people around me, I learned that empty nesting is more about a sense of loss and the need to find new purpose and passion while changing the relationships we once had with our children. It's possible that your best years are ahead of you, and how you choose to live will determine the outcome. I believe that most games are won in the second half, and that you, no doubt, have a beautiful, though possibly not easy, road ahead of you. It's odd for me to give a brief illustration about good wine, since I don't drink. But it's a fact that the aging of wine improves its quality. Sometimes, an aged wine is dramatically better and more distinguished because it is stored with care. As we age, we can learn from our experiences and improve our lives to finish well. It's my prayer that this book will help you do that. I've kept this quote from the Old Testament close to my heart. Be alert. Be present. I'm about to do something brand new. It's bursting out. Don't you see it? There it is. I'm making a road through the desert, rivers in the Badlands. Isaiah 43, verse 19. As you launch your kids into the world, be alert, present, and prepared. You're launching yourself as well. I hope you will make empty nesting a meaningful, rich, and even fun time amid struggle, perhaps a few tears, and grief. Your children are not who they once were, and neither are you. Let's get to know who that new person is. Chapter 1. Empty or Full? Challenge or Opportunity? Principle 1. When your child leaves home and their life fills up with fresh experiences, follow their lead. I miss their mess. I miss their noise. I miss their rudeness and neediness. I miss their laughter. I miss my place in their lives. Who am I, and what do I do with the rest of my life? How does the empty nest feel? You will get different answers from each person you ask, but one of the main reactions people have is usually one level deeper than their first answer. It's really, really quiet. Let's face it. From the moment you have a baby until the time you launch that child into adulthood, life is often busy and full of needs to meet. If you are like most parents, you put part of your life on the back burner for more than 20 years. Your world revolves around the kids' schedules, the kids' demands, and even the kids' chaos. Then one day, much of it is gone. The kids are eager to leave home and begin their lives as adults. Your house, and yes, even your life, feels, well, sort of empty. One mom we know said, "I survived 23 years of forced labor. Now that I have control of my schedule after all these years, I have no idea what to do with myself." During those days of hectic schedules, we yearn for quiet. But when it abruptly appears, the quiet can really mess with us. Kathy and I live exactly a half mile from our high school football stadium. For 9 years, this is where we spent our Friday nights in the fall. If the team had an away game, we drove to another stadium. You'd think that as parents of all girls, football would not be part of our lives, but all three girls were cheerleaders. So we faithfully climbed the stands to sit in the cheer section and watch the games. We were used to watching a lot of sports because the girls had been junior high cheerleaders as well as competitive cheerleaders on a travel team. Nothing like driving a van load of teenage girls from Orange County, California to Las Vegas for 3 days so they can perform their 2.45-minute routine twice. I remember the moment it all stopped. It was the first Friday night after we had taken our youngest to college. Kathy and I were sitting at the kitchen table. Suddenly, we heard the band playing and the announcer welcoming the cheering fans to the first football game of the year. We looked at each other and wondered whether we should go watch the last half. We didn't go to the game. The overwhelming atmosphere was that of a really quiet house. Our feelings and thoughts were all over the place. We felt a bit of aimlessness mixed with purposelessness and maybe some restlessness. At the same time, in that quietness, we felt an underlying dose of excitement and wonder. Just as our kids were going through their own rites of passage, so were we. Change and loss are deeply connected. Experts say that as your life changes and your kids move out of the house, you can experience an overwhelming sense of loss. Change and loss are deeply connected. Sometimes loss is as simple as that depicted in a cartoon I saw recently. It showed a mom and dad waving goodbye to their young adult child who is moving away from home. The husband turns to his wife who is crying and says, "Don't cry, honey. We will find other tech support." Yet many people feel a much deeper sense of loss, like the woman who told me, "The adjustment of not being part of my kids' day-to-day life hit me like a ton of bricks. I felt emotional pain and a loss of purpose." I think she sums up the feelings of many parents once their kids are given the passport to adulthood. The kids appear to be doing fine, but the parents are grieving the loss. The people who cope best with the empty nest are those who are willing to recognize their grief. It's possible that this period in your life will bring to the surface loneliness, doubt, and worry about the future. I remember staring at Kathy in silence one evening in our now noiseless home. I was excited that we could spend more time together, but also frightened that we had some work to do in our relationship. Our kids had been our major distraction, our excuse for a lack of connection. Would we have anything to say to each other? When I wrote the book Doing Life with Your Adult Children, I didn't realize I had hit on such a critical topic for parents with adult kids. The book kept selling, and the stories kept mounting. One of the key issues I chose not to write about in that book is the empty nest. Yet, since the book's publication, the topic has consistently surfaced in conversations and questions at every seminar, talk, or webinar I've given. It typically appears when discussing change and loss. So, I began to research life after the kids move out. The phrase empty nest syndrome showed up everywhere. The interesting fact about this syndrome is that it's not a clinical diagnosis or a mental disorder, but rather a feeling, an emotion, a mood, and even a burden. One woman put it this way: "I was terrified. I had no idea what I was going to do now that I was no longer anchored by school runs and filling the refrigerator. When I looked at my life, minus my children in the house, it looked dark and gloomy. I dreaded it."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.